I don't think that any of us realize today how much we are in spiritual bondage. When you stop and think, when you just try to imagine for just a moment, what we have waiting for us beyond this short life. I'm glad that I can stand here before you this morning and tell you, I know my Redeemer lives.
Amen.
I know He lives, and I know I'm ready to meet Him. I know I've got a home waiting for me in heaven. And we can't even imagine what's waiting for us there. If we could imagine just a little bit today, we would all be out of our seats. Shout hallelujah, Brother Smith.
Amen.
Hallelujah and Hosanna. Blessed is the Lord. I'm going to be reading from the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew's Gospel, in chapter 6. Beginning at verse 25, Matthew 6 and 25. This has been a wonderful day. We can't begin to count the blessings that God has given to us already. And it is a delight to be in the house of the Lord. I put my watch in my pocket just a moment ago. I don't know if there's anyone any more time conscious than Brother Stapleton. But I realize today that, you know, we need to be willing to wait on the Lord. And if you and I, you know, we maintain such control over our lives. And we need to release that control. We need to surrender our life, our will to God, every single one of us today. Those of us that are saved, that we would let God's Holy Spirit have free course in our life and in this worship service. And those of you that are lost and have not yet experienced God's saving grace, you need to let go also. And trust in the Lord to take you by the hand and lead you to that place where God has ordained for you. Where you can find the Lord and know Him as the Lord and Savior of your life. Matthew 6 and 25, therefore, Jesus said, I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what ye shall eat, or what ye shall drink, or yet for your body, what ye shall put on. Is not the life more than meat, and the body than raiment? Behold the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are ye not much better than they? Which of you, by taking thought, can add one cubit unto his stature? And why take ye thought for raiment, for clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Wherefore, if God so clothed the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall He not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? Therefore, take no thought, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or wherewithal shall we be clothed? For after all these things the Gentiles seek, for your heavenly Father knoweth that ye have need of all these things. I'm going to take my thought today from this next verse. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Take therefore no thought for the morrow, for the morrow shall take thought for the things of itself. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. And my title today is simple. Seek first kingdom of God. Seek first the kingdom of God. I was thinking after I arrived here this morning, in just a few months, in the month of June, on the fourth Sunday of June, our church will be having a revival meeting. We've had revival on this particular Sunday for many, many years. I don't know how many. It was set long before I arrived here. And the reason for revival meeting, those of us that are saved, we see and feel the need for spiritual renewal. We get cold. And I appreciate the wonderful presence of God's Spirit today. I'm grateful for everything that is done in this service already today. Brothers and sisters, I believe the evidence of our spiritual coldness is apparent. We need spiritual revival, a renewal. We need to get energized spiritually, fired up to serve the Lord, and that's what revival is about. We see the need and feel the need for that. And, the fourth Sunday of June is just a convenient time. It's a time that everyone was agreeable to, and we've been doing that for many years. It's proved beneficial. We see that need. Also, we're concerned for you that are lost. Our goal for us, for our church, is to be spiritually awakened and renewed, to be on fire for God. We'll begin to pray. I believe we'll begin to put forth a greater effort to serve the Lord. And we'll see some powerful services in the Lord, and hopefully those who are lost, those who are unprepared to meet God, will feel the presence of God's Holy Spirit and will be affected by it, and will see the need themselves to be saved. And I said all of that to say this. We don't know if we're going to live to see the fourth Sunday in June come. We don't know if the world's going to be standing in a few more months. But we're making preparation as though it will. And we hope and pray that we'll all be living, we'll all have the opportunity for that day to come. But especially for you that are unsaved, I remember as a young child growing up in church, I remember being lost, knowing that I was lost and separated from God. I remember wanting to be saved. I remember feeling deep within my soul the need to be saved and wanting to be saved. And even myself as a sinner longing for revival to come and thinking in my own mind, when it comes, I'm going to repent of my sins and I'm going to get saved. And the revival would come and I would sit on the back row and I would be frozen to the pew. You know, the evangelist would come and preach the gospel. The power of God would be moving in a mighty way, and I would be frozen to the floor. I felt that inside of me the desperate need of being saved. I knew within my soul that if I died in that condition, that I was going to spend eternity in hell, and I wanted to be saved. But I was frozen to the floor. And service after service after service would come, and the revival would come, and the revival would go. And it's like, I believe Jeremiah the prophet said, summer is ended, harvest is past, and still we are not saved. I hope that revival meeting will come. I hope we'll live to see it. But we may not. That is the reason why Jesus is telling us here, seek first the kingdom of God, and all these other things will be added unto you. In the book of Proverbs, 4th chapter, the 7th verse, Solomon said, wisdom is the principal thing. Wisdom, the right use of knowledge, is the most important thing. And folks, listen, we don't need very much knowledge at all to be wise. We just need to use the knowledge that God has given to us in the right way to make right decisions, wise decisions. And young people, especially for you, you have a wonderful opportunity for education today. And a wise person will choose to seek all of the knowledge and understanding that he can. That's why Solomon said wisdom is the principal thing. And he said, therefore, get knowledge, get understanding, and all by getting, get wisdom. Wisdom. Seek all of the education that you can. There's a familiar expression of being behind the eight ball. And in billiards, in pool, most people know that the worst place that you can be is to have the cue ball behind the eight ball, because you can't play off of the eight ball. It is an insurmountable obstacle in your way. And it has become a proverbial statement. We understand the meaning that to be behind the eight ball is to be in a bad way. And young people, if you neglect your education, if you fail to seek all the knowledge that you can, it's likely that you will be behind the eight ball for the rest of your life. You'll be handicapped. You'll be hindered. And so God's Word teaches us to be wise and to seek all the knowledge that we can. In Jeremiah 6 and 16, the prophet Jeremiah said, "Stand ye in the ways and see, and ask for the old path, wherein is the good way, and walk therein, and ye shall find rest for your soul." Now, Jeremiah talks about standing in the ways. And listen, there is an infinite number of ways that we can choose to live our life. An infinite number of ways that we can choose to go in our life. And Jeremiah, God's Word, God is telling us that we need to stand in the ways. We need to stop for a moment and examine those ways. And he said, look for the old path. But I want you to understand something. And the old path is plural also. There are many old paths. And just because some particular way of living or a pathway that we might take is old does not necessarily mean that it's right. There are many old paths that people are traveling in this world, but they're just one good way. One good way. And God's Word tells us to walk in that good way, and we'll find rest for our souls. What Jeremiah is saying here, I think, is simply this. Is we need to take some time to consider the way that we're going, the way that we're living, the decisions that we're making, and to prioritize those decisions. And God's Word gives us a leg up on the first priority in this life. And he says, seek first the kingdom of God. Seek that first. Everything else will be added to you. And Jesus was speaking in the context of what are we gonna eat today? You know, my dad, bless his heart, he gets up wondering what he's going to eat for breakfast. And he'll kill me if he ever hears this sermon on tape. But he's not hardly through with breakfast before he's wondering about what he's going to eat for dinner. And the dishes aren't even done then before he's wondering what he's going to eat for supper. And that's what Jesus is talking about here. Don't worry about what we're going to eat. Don't worry about wearing designer clothes, and don't worry about tomorrow. And he's telling us, you know, we can look around us in nature, and the fowls of the air, they don't labor in any way. They don't sow seeds, and they don't reap, and yet God feeds them every day. The lilies of the field, God clothes them. And even tomorrow, we don't have to worry about tomorrow. Tomorrow is in God's hands, and he tells us in his Word that if we'll seek first the kingdom of God, all of these things will be given to us. And Jesus tells us, your heavenly Father knows that you have need of all of those things. Every single one of them. Didn't he feed Israel in the wilderness? In a dry, barren desert. The God of heaven, the creator of the ends of the earth. He filled his people with food every day. And he caused their clothes not to wear out. Our God is able, folks, to take care of our needs, every single one of them, and he knows exactly what we stand in need of, and he urges us, you know, to forget about all of those things and think about this one thing, about seeking first the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Now, what does that mean? Seek first the kingdom of God. Can you imagine what the kingdom of God is? I forget how many verses of Scripture there are in this marvelous book. How many? The 66 books, you know, from the Old Testament to the New, and from Genesis to Revelation. This book tells us about the kingdom of God.
And God's Word urges us to seek that first. And I'm convinced that it involves knowing. Knowing absolutely for certain that I have a place in God's eternal kingdom. I mean, think about it for just a moment. Sitting here in your pew, close your eyes, whatever you want to do, and try to imagine what God has promised to us. That we could have a place in God's eternal kingdom. That our sins could be forgiven. It means that. That we could have a real relationship with God. That we could be brought out of this dead spiritual state that we're in, made alive, made new creatures in Christ Jesus. That we could know with absolute certainty that when we leave this life, that we've got a place in the kingdom of God. It means all of that. And so much, my speech is stammering today. And we need help from God's Holy Spirit just to grasp some little bit about what it means to have a part in God's eternal kingdom. And God tells us, seek that first. Make sure that, this is the pearl of great price that Jesus was talking about. It is the meaning of life. It's everything. If we miss that, we just missed it all. God's Word says, seek that first, and everything else will be given to you. There's more reasons why that we should seek God's kingdom first than we can talk about here in just a few moments' time. But I want you to indulge me just for a few moments to talk about a few reasons why we need to seek God's kingdom first. So I sat here and listened to David in Santa Cena. I can only imagine what heaven is going to be like. I know my Redeemer lives. I've never seen Him. I've felt His presence. I know that I'm saved. And I know that one of these days, folks, that my life is going to come to an end, and I know that I've got a place in that heavenly home. There's a childhood story about Peter Pan. This little child, Peter Pan, he goes to a place called Never Neverland. He's dreaming. And he goes to a place called Never Neverland, and it's a place where little boys never grow up. Sometimes that sounds pretty neat, doesn't it? When you get childhood, some of you probably still aren't children. We need to grow up. But I'm going to tell you, that's a fairy tale. That's a cunningly devised fable. It's for entertainment. That's all. But we're reading from a book that's God's inspired word. I want to tell you, we're going to a never land. We're going to a place, folks, where we'll never grow old. We're going to a place where we shall never die. We'll never feel any sorrow. We'll never feel any sadness. We'll never feel any suffering. We'll never say goodbye to our friends and loved ones. Listen, I know what it's like to be homesick. And my mom and dad and my dad's sister, they used to sing a song years ago. I'm homesick for heaven. I've got a longing to go. I know about that. I'm living here in West Tennessee, and I'm thrilled to death to be here. I've been your pastor for 20 years. I'm grateful for God's blessing, but I know what it's like to be homesick, to miss my family, to see the loved ones that I haven't seen in weeks and weeks and months and sometimes years. I know what it's like. We're going to a place where we'll never, ever have to say goodbye anymore. I miss my mom, and I miss my brother who died and gone to heaven. But they're living in a place that they wouldn't come back here, not for $1 million, not for all the gold and silver and diamonds and rubies in this world. Because they're in that place where there's never any sorrow, never any sickness, never any suffering of any kind. And they're sitting in the presence of the Lord, basking in His glory and His goodness, walking through that land that the Bible says the half has not been told to us. We can't begin to imagine what it's going to be like. Why in this world would anybody delay? And when you just think about living forever, we ought to seek first the kingdom of God, because no matter how long that you live here, no matter how many things that you possess, if it were possible for you to gain the whole world, what would it profit you if you lost your own soul? I'm so thankful for these ladies here, our 90s club. There's just four of them here.
in their 90s. One of them about to crack 100. And
they give me hope. You know, they give me hope that this, I'm not the young preacher anymore. And this old body, I wake up with a new ache, a new pain every day. Y'all don't have time for me to tell you about them all. But that's life here. You know, and if we lived 100 years, and I'm certain that if you would take the time to ask any one of these ladies about their life and about their experience, they would tell you that life here is short in comparison to eternity. It's nothing. It's as a tale that's told. It's like a watch in the night. It's like a second, a moment in time that's here and then it's gone. But eternity is waiting. And why in this world would anybody delay in seeking first the kingdom of God? Oh, for those reasons and for so many more, we need to seek God's kingdom first. And let God worry about all the insignificant details of our life here and everything that comes with it. Listen, folks, you need to seek first the kingdom of God. Because life here is uncertain. It's uncertain. James said it. James 4 and 14. He said that our life is like a vapor. He asked the question, what is your life? And he said it's like a vapor. It appears for a short while and then vanishes away. You know, vapor is just this cloudy mist blown by the wind. And that's the way our life is here. Just a misty, cloudy vapor that appears for just a little while and is gone. Job, in the Old Testament, the 14th chapter of Job, he says, man that's born of a woman is but a few days and then full of trouble. You know, we're just here for a short time. And life here is so filled with trouble that we need to seek first the kingdom of God. And I believe Solomon, in the book of Proverbs, he said, thou knowest not what a day may bring forth. We don't know what today holds, do we? We don't know if we'll see tomorrow the sunrise, not any one of us. We just simply don't know how many days that we're going to have here. Life is short. Life is uncertain. Life is cut too short for so many. And there's nothing any more important than seeking God's kingdom first. To know with absolute certainty, my sins are forgiven. I have a home waiting for me in heaven. Life is so uncertain. We need to seek first the kingdom of God because this world is full of evil. This world is full of evil. You know, Charlie Daniels popularized the song years ago, Devil Went Down to Georgia. I'm going to tell you, this week, just this week, the devil went down to Alabama. Just this week, the devil went to Germany. Just this week, the devil went down to a place called Maryville, Illinois. The devil went down there. Evil is present. Paul said, listen, folks. Paul said, when I would do good, he said, evil is present with me. And I want to tell you that evil is present right here in this very room this morning. Praise the Lord. God's Holy Spirit is here, but I'll guarantee you the devil is not far away. I'm wondering when the devil's going to come down to Tennessee and how he's going to raise his ugly head and what he's going to do. I am satisfied that those sleepy little towns in Alabama, that they felt like, evil is somewhere far off. Even in Germany, evil doesn't come to a place like this. And in Maryville, Illinois, I'm satisfied that those people sitting in that church house felt like they were saved. Never imagine that evil would be present in that very place. Y'all don't know this. The deacons and myself, we've been talking about putting in place a security team here. You know, because of the things that we're seeing in the news, the things happening in the world around us, thinking about, we're sitting here, how many doors? Y'all know how many doors there are to get in this place where we're sitting? How anybody could come from any direction to this little church. You know, this is just the truth. This is the evil world that we're living in. We've talked about doing that. We haven't done it yet. Patrick, you trip anybody comes in that door, will you? We need to seek first the kingdom of God, because this place that we're living in is evil. Explore evil, and life is uncertain. And evil is present with us this morning. We read in the Old Testament where Joshua, the high priest, stood before the Lord. And the scripture says that Satan stood right there in his presence, right in the face of the Lord. We read in the New Testament, I believe Luke's gospel, where the scripture says that Satan entered into Judas, his carrier. Do you know where they were? They were in that upper room. Judas was right there together with the Lord and with those 12 apostles, right in that upper room, one of the most sacred and spiritual places we read about in the New Testament. And God's word said that Satan was there and entered into Judas, said he put into his heart to do what? To betray the Lord. God knows that we sit in the presence of evil every day that we live. That's why you need to seek first the kingdom of God. That's why it is so important today. Now is the accepted time. Behold, today is the day of salvation. We need to seek first the kingdom of God, because these are perilous times. 2 Timothy chapter 3, Paul began by saying in verse 1 that in the last days, perilous times are going to come. We're living in the last days. And he gives us a big long list of things there. Perilous times are going to come. He said men would be lovers of their own self. He said that they would be fierce, that they would be traitors. You know why we're seeing all of these businesses collapse in our time? It's because people are traitors in their thinking. Lovers of themselves. Lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God, without natural affection. You know, we see people on the news just nearly every night about talking about Bernard Madoff. How can this man do that? Because he doesn't have natural affection, that he can swindle everybody in his life. And all of these businesses collapsing in the country in the shape that we're in, because we're living in perilous times. Check out the list that God has given to his people. You know, Jesus said that an evil and adulterous generation seeks after a sign, and no sign would be given to it. But I want to tell you that God gave to his disciples plenty of signs. When the Lord's disciples came and asked, when shall these things be? What shall this be the signs of thy coming? He gave them a whole list of signs of things to look for, that when Jerusalem was destroyed in 70 AD, they wouldn't be there. They saw the signs that God had given to them. They exited the city. He's given us plenty of signs in Matthew chapter 24. In 2 Timothy 3 and verse 1, and when you read the signs, Jesus tells his disciples, when you see all these things begin to take place, he said, know that it's near, even at the door. Listen, folks, I don't have the ability today to convince you of how urgent your need is to be saved, to seek first the kingdom of God, because it is the most important thing in this life. You know, we don't take time to read the book. You know, we don't take time to know and understand God's word. And God's word is telling us that the end is very near, and the signs are around us everywhere. Everywhere I go, and people say, I think the Lord's coming soon. We were sitting with Brother Randy and Sister Dawn last night over dinner, and Dawn said, I believe the Lord's coming soon. I believe it's here. And just nearly every time that we get together with somebody, somebody will make that statement. I believe the Lord's coming soon. You need to seek first the kingdom of God because of this. Jesus tells us, for you know not what hour the Lord doth come. He said it would happen like lightning that shines from the east even to the west. If you can imagine how fast light travels, you know, to try to get up. And that's what the Lord is telling us about his coming. It's going to happen just that fast. In a moment of a twinkling of an eye, the Lord is going to split the eastern sky. He's going to come in the clouds of glory with all of his holy angels with him. He's coming with 10,000 of his saints, the word says, to execute judgment upon all that are ungodly, upon those that know not the Lord. We need to seek first the kingdom of God because of all these things. Because of all these things. It's here. It's here. I've been praying for revival already. I've been praying for Brother Clint Ezell. I've been praying that God would just empower this church and liberate this church to realize the circumstance that we're in. And to burden our hearts for our friends and loved ones who are lost and unprepared to meet God. Because I believe with all of my heart and soul, the Lord's coming is near. This room is filled with people today that are unprepared to meet God. And I want to tell you something. It takes more than an intellectual knowledge about God and about Jesus Christ and about His Word. You need to have an experience with the Lord. Amen. You need to have a time and a place in your life where you know that you came to the Lord and acknowledge your sin. God exposes our sin. He opens our eyes to the truth. I saw myself as lost when I was a 10-year-old boy. And I under great conviction when I was 19. I struggled to find the Lord. I'm grateful He didn't give up on me. And over and over and over, God convicted my heart and my soul of my sin until one night in 1969, He convicted me deeply. I desperately recognized my need for salvation and I called on the Lord. He forgave my sin, and man, I want to tell you how wonderful it was.
Amen.
Peace of God. I tried to imagine a lot of things, Brother David, about the Lord, about heaven, about how wonderful it's going to be. And the older I get, the more I realize I don't belong to this world. I don't belong to this world. I belong to that never land. That my Lord has gone to prepare for me and for all of them that love His appearance. He tells us in John 14, I don't want you to be sorrowful. I want your hearts to be troubled. If you believe in God, believe also in me. And the very night before Jesus died, He knew they were going to be broken. He knew their hearts were going to be shattered. He knew they were going to face the awful reality of Christ's suffering and death on the cross of Calvary. He said, I don't want you to be troubled about this. You believe in God, believe also in me. He said, I'm going to prepare a place for you. A heavenly mansion. In my Father's house have many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going to prepare a place for you. And if I do, He said, I'm coming back to receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Where the Lord is, we'll be satisfied. We'll be at peace. We'll know that joy that's unspeakable. Friend, what about you? We're gonna pray a benediction here in just a moment. Short little prayer. We're gonna call it quits here at HMBC this Sunday morning, and we'll go our separate ways. I don't know if we'll send them back here tonight or not. I'm hoping and expecting that we will, but I'm concerned about you. I'm concerned about you walking out here in the streets of Huntingdon, Tennessee. I know this is a safe little place, it seems like it is, but I want to tell you, evil is present.
Amen.
Evil is everywhere. We don't know what people are capable of. We don't know what a day is going to bring. You need Jesus in your heart and your life right now. Eternity is waiting. A wise person will stop just for a moment and weigh all these things out and make a good, conscious decision to seek the Lord with all their heart and soul. God is in this place. I'm convinced today that God is knocking on someone's heart today. Jesus said, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man will hear my voice and open the door, I'll come into him and sup with him and eat with me. What was he talking about? I'll come into your heart. I'll come into your life. I'll give you peace and joy and forgiveness and hope and assurance of eternal life.
Amen.
What are you waiting for? What are you waiting for? God's command, seek first the kingdom of God. Everything else will take care of itself. And I'm telling you by experience that it does.
Amen.
Our God is able to satisfy our every need. And He does. We need more than your life this morning. Bring it to come to me and sing songs.
God been speaking to your heart today? Are you satisfied today that heaven's going to be your home? Is there any doubt in your mind, in your heart today? Do you know that it's real? That God is speaking to your heart today and inviting you to come and to receive the wonderful gift of God. Would you come? Would you seek Him? Would you seek first the kingdom of God this morning? Let the Lord take care of everything else in your life. Are we standing together? Number one.